I think you're going to need this.
All right, well, for those of you who may be new to the IOF Max Experience, welcome to the adventure. Donnie, thank you for that kind introduction. I'm Chris Rogers. I'm a physiatrist in private practice in San Diego. And I would like to thank the IOF team for this invitation to come speak with you today about the progress that's being made in the development and approval of a stem cell therapy. For those of you in the room, you probably know that this is the incorrect title, so let me give you the correct one. And I think that most of your patients with orthopedic conditions like mine ask you, when is the FDA going to approve stem cell therapy? This is a question I hear very often. So I'm hoping that this talk will help you answer that question. These are my disclosures. So first, I'd like to just talk a little bit about heroes. So we all have our heroes in the movies. And in 1981, director Steven Spielberg and George Lucas introduced us to Indiana Jones. But if we're lucky, we also have heroes in real life, mentors who guide us, support us, and have the vision to show us what is possible for the future. In that same year, 1981, when I was still in high school, I was fortunate to have such a mentor. Dr. Marshall Uris was an orthopedic surgeon and the director of the UCLA Bone Research Lab. And he and his team of scientists were pioneers in the field of bone morphogenetic protein. After all, that's where it was discovered. And BMP are growth factors which are critical for bone and cartilage development, repair, and regeneration. And I learned a lot about regenerative medicine back in the 80s with Dr. Urist, and he was the one who encouraged me to go to medical school, after all. Now later, I would learn that he was friends and colleagues with one of our heroes, Dr. Arnold Kaplan. And you've seen this picture before, but if you look closely, you'll see the impact that these gentlemen had on each other in the 80s, because after all, Marshall's picture is hanging on Arnie's wall. So I was fortunate also to know Arnie and benefit from his wisdom and good sense of humor. And he's, of course, known for having described and discovered and characterized the mesenchymal stem cell and publishing in 1991. And he inspired people around the world on this idea of a stem cell, including former First Lady Nancy Reagan, who urged researchers to make use of the opportunities available and to do all they could to translate stem cell research into clinical medicine. And Dr. Kaplan, one of his great gifts was that he didn't just stay in the lab. He was very keen on seeing this translated to clinical practice. And you see him here lecturing to us many, many times. You've seen this where he says, MSCs are not stem cells. He educates us that they modulate the immune system. They are eaten up by the monocytes and are responsible for that macrophage conversion that occurs. And they are also pro-regenerative. And he would go on to say, it's actually time to change the name. So this is something you've heard before. But it kind of threw us for a loop when he said that, because we were calling them stem cells for so long. But it's not inconsistent with the science at the time. The ISCT put forth their recommendations in 2005 to call it the multipotent mesenchymal stromal cell. And they had their definitions, which included plastic adherence. Certain CD markers needed to be present. They had to have tri-lineage differentiation capabilities. And then in 2013, they asked us to add bioassay for immunosuppressive abilities of the MSC, and also later to add functional assays to define the therapeutic mechanisms of action in the product. So Dr. Kaplan would go on to say MSCs are not stem cells, they are better. And he encouraged us to use them. He said in this paper, this commentary in Nature in 2019, they work, so use them. But how can we use them? Well, we do have bone marrow aspirate concentrate, which has a small number of MSCs as well as some other beneficial ingredients. MFAT maybe has a little bit more. But if you want to isolate the MSC and enzyme digest the adipose tissue, to release the adipocytes, and you get what's called the stromal vascular fraction. If you remove the plastic adherent MSC cell and grow them in culture to tens or 20 or 100 million cells, then you have what's commonly referred to as the MSC product. However, you know that these require FDA approval. Now, if you are trying to bring your device to the market with certain claims, then you need to get FDA approval to conduct clinical trials under an investigational device exemption, or IDE. And currently, there are a few that have that are involved in this. Get this remote working for you yet? So Ingeneron has a bedside device that manufactures SVF. GID Bio also has a SVF manufacturing device. And then there's Lipogems, which manufactures MFAT with their big shiny balls. All right, so Ingeneron last year released their results of their clinical trial looking at patients with partial thickness rotator cuff tears, showing very good benefit at long-term follow-up, 3.4 years. And also the much-awaited MILES study was released last year, and our friend Ken Mountner and others, phase 3 clinical trial on knee osteoarthritis, and showed some surprising results, which maybe we'll hear about from some of the other speakers at this meeting. And it just highlighted the need to do further analysis to really understand which patients are going to be those best responders. GID is making progress with their pipeline towards a treatment for osteoarthritis using a stromal vascular fraction product, thanks largely to our friend Jaime Garza, who in 2020 published the phase 2 study showing superiority over placebo. And it's very likely that GID has now completed their phase 3 pivotal study. Lipogems also was granted an IDE last year, and their study is ongoing, and we look forward to the results from them as well. Now, if you're a drug manufacturer, if you're trying to produce culture-expanded MSCs, you need to go through a regulatory pathway and get approval to do those clinical trials under an investigational new drug, or IND, which got me thinking. Sorry, couldn't help myself. So Dr. Kaplan started this company, Osiris, in 1992, the year after he released that paper on the mesenchymal stem cell, and the company was named after Osiris, which is the Egyptian god of the afterlife, resurrection, and fertility. And 20 years later, they actually brought the first stem cell product to the world. It was approved by our friends in Canada, by the regulatory agency, Health Canada, and it was for their product, remestemcel, which is used for the treatment of graft versus host disease. And this was particularly satisfying because this is a disease that afflicts children. Now, there have since been only 11 more MSC products that have been successful in obtaining regulatory approval around the world. They are listed here. Most of them are derived from adipose or bone marrow-derived MSCs. They have a host of conditions for which they are beneficial. And you see most of this work is really being done in South Korea. But what about knee osteoarthritis? We all treat knee osteoarthritis, and our patients ask us every day, when are we going to have an FDA-approved stem cell therapy for osteoarthritis? Well, there are more than 27 million Americans with knee osteoarthritis, more than 650 million more than 650 million people around the world. And this is projected to increase as the population ages, which means that you're going to see more knee osteoarthritis in your office. There's a high chance that you'll get knee osteoarthritis. Matter of fact, even Harrison Ford has knee osteoarthritis, because when he was filming this scene battling with this brute in Raiders of the Lost Ark, he actually tore his ACL when that plane rolled over his knee. So it's very common, and it's no surprise then that there are many remedies out there that people are searching for, some of which have evidence to support the benefit of them, very few which actually have FDA approval. Anybody can go on Amazon now, that's your new pharmacist, so you can go and buy pretty much anything you want on that website, including my personal favorite, which is Swollen of Knee Cure Oil. truly exists. We're going to talk about some of the injections that are used for osteoarthritis later in this lecture. And of course, when those don't work, we have surgical options available to our patients. But none of these treatments cure osteoarthritis, and only a handful of them are actually FDA approved. Matter of fact, in this review of recent innovations in cartilage regeneration strategies for the treatment of knee osteoarthritis, the authors note that currently there are no FDA approved treatments that are shown to regenerate articular cartilage. So for that, we might need to travel over to Asia. In South Korea, the Korean Ministry of Food and Drug Safety has approved CARTISTEM, which is manufactured by MetaPost. It's an allogeneic umbilical cord-derived MSC product that is combined with hyaluronan and is implanted in a surgical microfracture procedure that you see here, and it produces that beautiful hyaline cartilage. Phase 1-2 study here with just 7 patients who were surgically implanted with this product were able to show mature repair of tissue at 12 weeks on arthroscopy, and it showed clinical improvement out to 7 years. Lim, in a phase 3 randomized clinical trial where patients received either that product or microfracture alone, showed no difference between surgery and surgical implantation of CARTISTEM at 48 weeks. However, when you go beyond 48 weeks, you can see the differences that occur between the two groups. And those benefits lasted out to 5 years. Now, Chris Joe wondered if perhaps we could just simply inject these cells into the joint to attempt to regenerate cartilage. And he did a dose-ranging study in 2014, where patients received either 10, 50, or 100 million cultured MSCs, and he was able to show improvement in the cartilage defects and the increase in cartilage volume, but these benefits were only seen in the high-dose group. And then Kim produced also a placebo-controlled trial comparing this saline, and also was able to show benefit in the treatment group out to 5 years. So really showing some strong durability. There's really not much else I've seen that you can inject in a knee that gives that kind of durability. Kim produced this phase 3 multi-center double-blind placebo-controlled trial. 261 patients randomized to receive 100 million adipose MSCs versus normal saline, and showed that most of the patients in the treatment group were able to exceed MCID for WOMAC. And this allowed them to apply to the Japanese government, the Pharmaceutical Medical Device Agency, and they got an approval in Japan. So this really excited the scientists of that study, and so they applied to South Korea agency. However, they were rejected based on the interpretation of a lack of clinical significance. So you can see we are still struggling to get approval on some of these products. So what's going on back in the United States? The most regulated country in the world. Well, Osiris, after their success getting approval in Canada, sells the stem cell business to Mesoblast. And Mesoblast has ambitions to develop their product here in the US and get an FDA approval. But as you know, that's not so easy. And it's a little bit like going after the Holy Grail. And before you go after the Holy Grail, you have to realize that there are 3 challenges that you will be faced with. And those 3 challenges are: is your product safe? Does your product beat placebo? And at what dose does it do that? And you have to prove that it produces a clinically relevant benefit that correlates with the potency assay that you choose for the mechanism of action that you propose that your MSC has in a large study and with long-term follow-up. So no problem, right? So Mesoblast has now tried to get approval in the US. They've submitted multiple phase 3 phase 3 trials. They made a 3rd attempt last year, and again, they were rejected. And this led the CEO of Mesoblast in the annual report to state, well, of course, we were very disappointed, but they're going to provide more data to the FDA on their potency assay to make sure that there's consistency. And this is one of the key issues, is showing that the MSC product is consistent from one study to the next and from one dose to the next. So this really leads to the challenge of that there are so many choices to be made in your clinical research development program. You have to ask yourself, well, what is the best medical indication for our MSC product? What are the inclusion-exclusion criteria? What are the phenotypes that we should be looking at in that medical indication? Which patients are going to be the best candidates? And what did you learn from the non-responders in your pilot studies? What is the best tissue source from MSC? We know that adipose, bone marrow, and umbilical cord are the most studied. What are the best manufacturing methods? Should the MSCs be primed for fitness? Should they be preconditioned in a hypoxic environment? Should they be co-cultured with interferon to make them more suitable for an inflammatory environment? What is the optimal dose? Is repeat dosing advised? And then what are the clinically relevant outcome measures that you're going to study? And how do you show that these outcome measures actually correlate with your proposed mechanism of action of your MSC product? And which potency assays do you use to look at that, and what are the optimal follow-up time points to show that there is durability of your product? And if you submit your data from your clinical trials to the FDA and they don't like it, you get this letter, refusal to file, which really is just a nice way of saying you have chosen poorly. And so in the search of finding the best MSC source, there's a couple meta-analyses, and we'll go through these quickly, but you can find meta-analyses that go both ways. This one happens to show that adipose MSC products produce superior outcomes with regard to pain and function, but there's good safety in these studies. Which is a better source of the donor? Should the patient be their own donor? As you see here, most of the studies are using autologous products, but there are several that use an allogeneic product. And when you look at those in a meta-analysis, and this is a good one, by the way, Kopp et al. In 2023, I'd recommend everyone take a look at that. They showed that basically all but one study showed that MSC was superior to placebo at 12-month follow-up, but there was no clear correlation between dose, MSC, tissue of origin, or donor source. So we have not a lot of guidance from the published literature yet. I was able to pull out two papers that I thought got as close to an apples-to-apples comparison as you could get. One study was a randomized clinical trial that used an allogeneic adipose-derived MSC product. The other used an autologous adipose MSC product. They were both produced by the same authors with similar protocols. And if you put them side by side, you can see allogeneic on the left, autologous on the right. The baseline characteristics in terms of duration of pain, severity of knee osteoarthritis is similar. If you look at the baseline pain and WOMAC function, they are also similar. They had a similar dosing schedule, 50 million cells repeated twice. But you see better outcomes in the group that received the autologous product, with also significant improvement in cartilage volume and fewer adverse events. So I'm going to give the medal to autologous. Does MSC therapy promote cartilage regeneration? Well, in this meta-analysis that I'm recommending you read, looking at 15 RCTs that measured cartilage status, 10 of the 15 were able to show evidence of cartilage repair. And furthermore, repeat dosing seemed to produce better outcomes, which is why I'm a fan of MSC banking. Full disclosure, my fat is in this bank as well, where it's cryopreserved at negative 180 degrees. Is stored in an FDA-registered and federally licensed tissue bank, and we can get many, many vials of MSCs with about 12 million MSCs per vial. They essentially remain at their current age and health for decades, and once we have an FDA approval, this provides a virtually unlimited number of treatments for the future. So there are some ongoing clinical trials on MSC, some of which have been completed. Mayo having completed their Reclaim Knee study. We'll look forward to the publication of those findings. You can see adipose and bone marrow, again, are the most commonly used products. And typically, we're looking at knee osteoarthritis and disc degeneration in these ongoing studies. And these will come out in the next few years. Full disclosure, I'm medical director for this company that we thought we would throw our hat into the ring as well. And so we have this study that is currently in review and hopefully published this year, where we looked at stromal vascular fraction that was manufactured in a GMP facility. And that way we can characterize the viability, the potency, the purity. It's a well-characterized product. About 20% of those cells are the adipose-derived MSCs. And we were able to show good outcomes at mean follow-up of 2.5 years. You see most of the benefit increase in KOOS occurring in that first 3 months, but the benefits are maintained out to that 2.5 year time point, with about 3 out of 4 patients exceeding MCID for KOOS. So in summary, when you go back to your clinics to fight the battle, I want you to always remember to keep the faith. Because someday, we will be able to tell our patients that we have an FDA-approved stem cell therapy for knee arthritis. Just don't ask me when it's going to be. Thank you to our heroes, our mentors, and thank you for your attention.